Today we'll cover chapter 8, services and labor. This week we will discuss about services. General agreement on trade in services, shortly we call GATS, General Agreement on Trade in Services. And then after we look into some of the important aspect of international labor law and human rights. Because when we talk about services, labor also we cannot ignore. Labor movement very important. We need to pay them salary, we need to take care of their welfare, so the human rights also comes into the discussion. GATS, General Agreement on Trade in Services. GATS is a multilateral agreement that came into effect as one of the three main annexes of WTO, similar to what we learned in the GATT in the last class. GATT contains rules and principles that governs the services, and it advocate liberalization of services. Advocate liberalization of services. Over here, GATT advocate liberalization of goods transaction. Over here, advocate liberalization of services. That means in terms of tax, for example, removal of tax, preferential tariff, preferential tariff also removal. So here we advocate of removal of those barriers in transaction of services. Three major components. Number one, the agreement itself we call framework agreement, FA, which contains the rules applicable to all the members who participate in the WTO. Number two, the sectoral annexes. As we see in the GATT, the annexes are more towards the industry, textile industry, clothing industry, cement industry, right? But over here, more to sector. For example, air transportation services, banking, finance, construction. So we'll look at it, some of the example annexes. We'll look at it later. The third one is the national schedule of specific commitment each member has agreed to undertake. So basically they have FA, then the sectoral annexes, and the third one is a special commitment by the members to liberalize or advocate the liberalization of services sector. FA, we call it framework agreement. So what are the key issues that have been discussed in the FA? The scope and the definition of GATS, we'll look at it later. The general obligations and the discipline of members. What are the obligations and disciplines of the members need to be observed? What are the specific commitment of the member state? And what the schedule would like to advocate in the progressive liberalizing? So when we say advocate liberalization, we refer to a progressive approach. Progressive approach. As we saw in the GATT. For example, progressive approach means what? If the tariff is 40%, now it has to reduce to 30% in the following year. For example, this is the first year, second year 30%, then third year 20%, then it reduces further. So we call this a progressive approach. Normally, WTO encourages a progressive approach. We don't want to have a drastic approach. The institutional structure of GATS and what are the miscellaneous provisions on the GATS. Different from GATT in that instead of one set of obligations that apply to everyone, GATS has two sets of obligations. That means it's separate into two. One is applied to all the members, the other one is only to specific members. One is to all general measures that apply to all affecting the trade and services. The other one is a set of principles and rules that apply only to specific, not like the GATT, where it cut across the whole industry. But over here, the GATS has some waiver for certain sector. It could be due to many reasons. One of the reasons is to differentiate the development of sectors between developing and developed nations. So this is one of the reasons why they want to differentiate between the developing and the developed nation. So there are some set of principles and rules that apply only to specific sectors. This is one example of telecommunication. It's an important sector covered by GATS. Okay, scope and definition of the framework agreement. So here we look, would like to, as I mentioned to earlier, one of the component of the FA is to define what is sector, sorry, what is service. What is service? In a layman term, service means what? Am I giving a service now? Yeah, I'm giving a service now to transmit the knowledge or message to a group of students. How do you define? Over there is very text oriented. How would you define service? How we are helping someone. How would you define service? Intangible, something you cannot see. Okay. How would you define service? Banking, hospital, by giving the examples. Okay. So let's see what they have defined over here. Very much text oriented. Services are an act or action such as the work performed by one person for another. As I mentioned earlier, there is a human element compared to the goods. A human element in the service. But there are also technology making the services, making the human invisible as well. Let me show you some examples. So human element. Human. For example, technology makes the services where you don't have to be handled by a human. For example, you want to transfer money from one country to another country, you can transfer through a wire transfer, but to operate it, we still need a human, a partial human. Maybe not 100% human as what we need to have in those days without technology. But with technology now, the services still need to be done. Maybe a partial commitment from the human. For example, a wire transfer fund, you withdraw money from ATM machine, but we still need a human to upload the money there so that you can withdraw, or someone to monitor those transactions in the server and so on. So let me repeat, services are an act or action such as the work performed by one person for another. So as you mentioned just now, hospital providing service, on for example like medical tourism. Medical tourism is one of the service which is very popular now. Medical tourism is a service where the tourists come to Malaysia to receive treatment. Transfer money is a service between state, between cross border transfer fund. Give me one example of service other than the two. The sectors that we can use is, for example, finance, banking, transportation, telecommunication, hospitality, so many more. Can you give one example? What they do? You postal services, also part of the international service, postal services. Service sectors are any part of the economy involving the performance of a service, banking, as I mentioned to you earlier, finance, insurance, telecommunication, transportation, hospitality, that handles the medical tourism and so on. Services, in terms of value, is very much high value compared to goods. For example, in Malaysia, the medical tourism is worth of 50 billion, you know. RM, 50 billion. Not now, by 2020. By 2020. So it's a very much high value added compared to goods. Singapore, the service sector is very much developed compared to goods, manufacturing and so on. Hong Kong also very much depend on the economy, depends on the service. So service is something we need to really understand in terms of international trade and law, so that the transaction goes smoothly and how the international dispute been settled and so on. This important sector. Trade in services. So defined by looking into the four modes of supply. So what are the four modes of supply in the trade in services? Number one. So these are some examples that I gave here. Number one. These are the four modes of supply. So I give some examples. For example, number one, cross-border supply of services that do not require the physical movement of either the supplier or the consumer. In telecommunication, there is no physical movement of the supplier or consumer. It's all done through the wire or wireless. So there is no physical movement of either party. You can stay still there, and the other party stay still, and the service can be exchanged. Example is telecommunication. So this is one mode of supply of service. So as I mentioned to you earlier, service not necessarily has to be mobile. Goods must mobile, must move. So we call it mobile. M-O-B-I-L-E. Mobile. goods must move. Even how you going to receive the goods? So must move, must be mobile. But services don't have to. It can be static, especially on the first mode of supply. So not necessarily it can be static, especially on the first mode of service, static on the telecommunication para. Transfer of money. The money don't have to move physically, but the money can move from account to an account through a wire transfer. But we're not taking the money. The money is not moving in the wire, so it's not moving. But the transaction is taking place. So we can say the first mode of supply. Number two, the supply of services that require the consumer to go to the supplier. This second mode of supply, where the consumer has to move to the supplier, especially on tourism. On the medical tourism, for example, the patient has to travel from Indonesia to Malaysia to get the treatment. Or you need to go to Paris to see the Eiffel Tower. So you need to move to the supplier. The consumer has to move to the supplier. Second mode, tourism. Education? Can you use the second mode, education? Like for example, you come from all the way to Iran to be here to get your degree. But there is one mode of learning now where you don't have to travel. E-learning, Where you don't have to move at all. You can finish all your studies through e-learning. There's another mode of study also, we call it a la carte university. Have you heard of it? A la carte university? A la carte university also, you don't have to move around. A la carte university means you can take one subject in USM, another subject from Hong Kong University, you can take another subject in Brunei University, you can take another subject in Singapore University, and you get one degree from all the four universities where all the four logos will be there. We call a la carte university. But in Asia, it is not so popular. But in Western, very popular. A la carte, like you order food, you want to have a mixture of food, isn't it? You don't want to have the buffet food. That's what you do here. Whatever the USM offer, you have to take, isn't it? A la carte, no. A la carte means you order what you like. You like USM because of one subject in USM. Another subject been taught by one of the famous lecturer in Singapore, you go there and take that subject. Another lecturer you like because he really make the class interesting, go to Hong Kong, example. So you take what you like. At the end, you still get a degree of management from all the four universities, for example, we call a la carte. So for that case, still, you may not have to have physical movement if it is e-learning, but if you education required to go, for example, we come all the way from Iran, then we can use it over here for the second mode of supply. Number three, services supplied by a service supplier from one member state by means of commercial presence in another member's territory. I repeat, services supplied by a service supplier, a bank for example, from one member state by means of a commercial presence in other member's territory, for example, like banking. Like for example, CIMB Bank is opening many branches in all over Asia, like Cambodia, like Singapore, and so on. So it's a physical presence in that particular country. Third mode of supply. Number four, services supplied in a territory of one state by a service supplier from another state by temporary presence of natural person. Example, like construction. So you go to, for example, like Malaysian, a lot of Malaysian companies like Ever Sendai, do a lot of construction work in other countries like Cambodia, India, Myanmar. So they go there, do the construction temporarily, and they come back. They don't stay there. Okay? They are there only on temporary basis until the construction is complete. It's also a service. So we call that fourth mode of supply. So please underline this. I suppose to underline this. So these are the four modes of supply. First, physical movement not required. Static. Number two, where the customer have to move to the supplier side. Number three, we need a commercial presence in other state. Number four, is a temporary arrangement until the completion of that particular service. So these are the four modes of supply that can take place in the services. But in GATT, under the goods, mobility is the only one mode of supply that we always talk about. Ecuador et al. Versus European communities. European communities was used before the formation of EU. Okay, this is a classic case. You can see banana on the slide. See, because of banana also there's a case, you know. Banana is very popular commodity in the world. Which country is the biggest exporter of banana?
Venezuela.
I don't know, I just want to ask you. Because over here they don't mention. But what I want to tell you is, banana is one of the important commodity in the world. As sugar cane. Which country? Venezuela. Central America, Latin America, these are the biggest exporters of banana because of the Katulistiva. You know, Katulistiva, which cut across our country as well, but we don't plant as in a bigger scale as what other countries are doing. Okay, banana over here. So banana is one of the important commodity being imported by European Commission communities. So the EU appeal from the findings in the panel reports. What happened is EC legislation, the European Communities legislation and regulations provided a preferential tariff for the EC member countries. So they provide a tariff. That means preferential tariff means what? A lesser tariff. Okay, preferential tariff means lesser tariff, which is one part of the tax as well. And the GATS advocate removal of those tax. Okay, so the case is talking about where the EC imposing preferential tariff on the members, and the EC is saying that we can impose those tariffs because it is not part of the GATS. And that's the whole case all about. So let me read for you. The EU appeal from the findings in the panel report, this is some of the introduction, on the importation, sale and distribution of banana, where they say it is not part of GATS. And see what is the outcome of this case. So EC legislation and regulation provided the preferential tariff treatment for the colonies of EC members who are importing the banana to the EC. So preferential tariff means lower tariff compared to other tariffs, but still a tariff that makes the banana price go up. So panel say EC violated the GATT and GATS. So which one to follow? They say violated both GATT and GATS. Which one to follow? So they have brought up this case, and EU is challenging whether it is GATS or the JTS. Okay. So the issue is, does GATS apply to EC import licensing procedures? So because they are providing preferential tariff, does the GATS governing those importation of banana to those countries? So the ruling says what? The actions of banana wholesalers in purchasing the banana, okay, and reselling it and conducting a variety of related services, for example packaging, reselling to retailers, selling to the bigger supermarkets, all these governed by GATS, and we have to follow what the GATS say about importation of banana to the country. But earlier the argument is all these activity not part of GATS, because the GATS comes in after GATT. So they say go ahead and impose tariff, because we don't have this doesn't come under GATS. So the ruling came out to be no, it is under GATS, because you are importing it, you are repackaging it, you are reselling it to those retailers and so on. So comes under the GATS, and you have to understand what GATS say about this activity, where we are advocating liberalization of services. So the preferential tax is not supposed to be. What other framework the FA trying to mention? Remember, when I talk about the components of FA, one is definition, where we talk about the banana case, where the definition say yes, it comes under the GATS. Now we're going into the general obligations and disciplines. Under the general obligations, we go back to what we learn in the goods, MFN and the transparency. MFN and the transparency. MFN means what? What is MFN means? Most favor. That is there. It's there, it's there. Which we learn in the GATT. They have similar MFN policies. Okay, let me repeat. Two general obligations apply to all WTO members. MFN, which acronym stands for Most Favored Nation, and transparency. What does the MFN say in the GATT? No, GATT. What MFN say? Example.
One state cannot reduce taxes to another state. Okay, why other state they have the higher tax?
Okay.
The state cannot make the definition between the nations.
You don't differentiate.
All must be equal.
Remember, I give you example. In this class, all are equal to me. You come from Iran, you come from Hong Kong, you come from South Korea, you come from India, you come from China, all are equal to me. So, most favored students. In GATT or GATS, we call this most favored nation. What does it say? That's what it was mentioned just now. Let me read for you the definition. MFN treatment requires that each member state accord immediately and unconditionally to services and services suppliers of other member treatment no less favorable than the any other country. That means you treat them equal, in a very layman term, treat equally. This is Latin America selling banana to me, let me impose them higher tax compared to India selling banana to Malaysia. Can we do that? We can't do that, because under the MFN, similar to goods, even services also same. We have to treat them same. Why, just now the case of a banana, why it comes under goods? Why it comes under service, not goods? It's also goods, you know. But in this case, they are also doing other value-adding activity. Once you import, yes, JTT. But after you import, what happens? You repackaging it, you are bringing down the volume to smaller packaging, then you're selling to retailers, comes under service. That's why JTT and JTS comes in the picture. Next, transparency. Requires members to publish all the national measures and international agreement that affect the JTS obligation. That means you make it open. Tell to everyone what is your policy. So that people know, the nation know, selling to you, what is the regulation they have to meet. Some of the specific commitments. Remember I told you, we have a specific commitment that we need to understand. JTS is designed to open up specific service sectors of the members market. For example, remember here, we want to make sure we differentiate between the developing and the developed nation. So JTS is designed to open up specific service sector of the member market to international access on a sector by sector and state by state basis. We don't want to open it up to all sector, to all nation. We go by sector, state by state. Okay, that's why we put here sector by sector, state by state. A specific commitment. We don't do it all at one time. Members submit, let's say you want to protect your industry, you want to protect your sector, for example, construction sector, I want to protect, you apply to the JTS. They'll give you a specific commitment. Example here, members submit a schedule or a specific commitment for annexation to JTS. That lists the sector that is opening up to market access. Or you don't want to open it up, you also mentioned over there. So the member may also list limitations that apply to those sectors. So you can mention what are the sectors you are opening up, where you are removing tax, okay, and also limitation to those sectors where you are imposing tax. So we call this what? Transparency. We call it transparency. That means you must tell to the WTO, I'm opening up my sector. That means I'm removing my barriers. Then you also can open it up and tell them, I'm also putting some limitation to this sector because it is still in the early stage of the industry or sector in my country. So you can put some barrier, so that you don't disrupt your local industry or local sector. You can do that. Continue on specific commitment. So for sector listed in a member state schedule of specific commitment, the member must observe two obligations. Example, market access and national treatment. Market access is giving services and service suppliers or other members treatment no less favorable than that listed in the member's schedule based on your limitation or your opening up. So depends on that, your market access. And the other one, in national treatment, is giving service and service supplier of other member treatment no less favorable than what is members grants in own like services and service supplier. That means under a specific commitment you must be transparent. If you want to have equal competition, open it up. Or you want to limit the competition, you want to put some barrier, you can. In the terms of market access and national treatment, you can mention it clearly to the JTS. Transparency again. I come back to this approach where we talk about progressive liberalization, where I wrote it somewhere. This progressive approach is very crucial. Progressive approach, progressive liberalization. This is the spirit that WTO advocate. Progressive liberalization. long-term objective of GATS is to encourage the member state to open the service sector to all the nations that are trading with them. Members shall engage in rounds of negotiation. So they can talk about this engagement. We call it rounds of engagement as we learn in the GATT. And these are all overseen by the Council for Trade in Services under the GATS. Okay, this some of the annexes by sector. Example, this is annex on movement of natural person supplying services under the agreement, annex on air transport services, financial services, so all go by sector. On the maritime transport services, on telecommunications. So these are some of the agreement that you make with GATS on the particular sector. You don't have to go and read all this, but you must be aware there are rules and regulation by sector. In GATT, rules and regulation by industry. Okay, so for each WTO member state is required to submit for annexation to GATS as scheduled. If you want to differentiate, or if you want to open up, okay, if you want to open up your sector to everyone to come and compete, or if you want to limit your sector from competition, you still have to apply to the GATS. We call it a schedule or specific commitment, as I mentioned earlier. So for each sector, it is scheduled must specify. These are some of the items that you need to specify in the schedule. For example, the term limitation. For example, you want to say in the construction sector in my country, if I'm Cambodia, I will not have free service or free trade in the service sector because the construction in Cambodia is still growing. So you can put a limitation over there, and also conditions on market access. For example, in Cambodia, if you want to get construction service from another country, they cannot come as 100% private investor. They need to come with maybe a joint venture, not 100% equity owned in Cambodia. At least a set by the government of Cambodia. So you can put this kind of a limitation in the schedule. You can do that. Like in Malaysia, many years ago, you must have a local participation, 40% of equity. Only last year, the government removed it totally. So we can allow 100% equity owned by foreign investors. We can. So this is what we call some of the conditions that you can put in the specific commitment. You can. Condition, qualification of national treatment. Yeah, you can do that. That's what I mentioned to you earlier. Undertakings are relating to additional commitment, how you're going to implement, how long, the time frame, and the date and the commitment. So you mention all this in detail under the commitment. Before we go to the NAFTA, we also going to compare with EU. How the GATS in EU? Then we go to NAFTA as well. How GATS implemented in EU? Let's look at it. The EC treaty provides that within the EU, restrictions on the freedom of to provide services and restrictions on the freedom of establishment are to be abolished. See, GATS advocate free trade, liberalization in trade services. But you must remember, in EU, they also advocating the same thing. So, it's been abolished. The freedom to provide services is the right of the member state. Wonderful, huh? So, they advocate as what GATS advocate. Similar freedom in trade services, liberalization trade services. So, the EU law on trade in services. example, an EC treaty declare that the self-employed and the employees of service suppliers are entitled to travel freely within member state. Mobility comes in, mobility. Mobility of human movement. For example, if you want to get a service from an employee from another country in EU to come to your country to provide the labor service, you don't have to put barrier. They can move freely. 2006 Service Directive requires EU members to simplify procedures required to access and exercise a service activity. So the states can limit entry. They only can limit entry of humans based on safety, based on public security and public health. Maybe they have some issues with the spread of diseases, they can put a restriction. Other than that, they can move freely. NAFTA. So look like EU providing a very good support on JTS. A good support on JTS. Now we look at NAFTA. In fact, NAFTA, they're giving more privileges as what mentioned JTS. Yes, now EU supports the JTS. But NAFTA trading bloc providing privileges even better than what is mentioned in the JTS. That's why NAFTA is one of the most successful trading blocs in the world. In the world. Why I say so? Because even EU is one of the success model of trading blocs that advocate liberalization of trade services and goods, but they have a lot of issues in terms of governance, they have a lot of issues in terms of success of the economy. But compared to NAFTA, in terms of success, in terms of profitability of the firms, in terms of economy of the overall nation in the NAFTA, Mexico, US and Canada, they are much more successful compared to EU. But in terms of member nations are very less compared to EU. Over there they have 117, over here only got 3. There are some differences between NAFTA and GATS. Each NAFTA country required to accord the better of national or MFN treatment. That means what? That means I not only treat equally other nation, but treat better in other nation. That means I keep on improving my service. For example, I have a service in my country, then I receive service from another country, I treat them even better compared to my own. This is what we call. But the issues of equal treatment comes in. But here in the spirit of betterment, so there is no issues of discrimination. If you treat less, then it's a problem. But if you treat it better and better, discrimination doesn't come into the picture. Service providers have several important rights that are different from GATS provisions. For example, to be free from performance requirements. For example, earlier we talked about performance of the banks, performance of the construction, performance of the four modes of supply. Over here, no. To make inward and outward transfers. So the governance of the NAFTA don't only talk about going out, it also talks about the inner state between the inner nations in the NAFTA, between the countries Canada, US and Mexico. To have international standard of care doctrine of apply, because over here we talk about better service compared to the local, so we also apply this standard of care doctrine. That means you care more to the member nation, care more. And the last one is to have investor state disputes resolved by binding arbitration. I mean, let's say you have issues between the nation. In NAFTA, we have a binding arbitration. That means you mention clearly, if there is an issue, we will use this arbitration process. Mention clearly. NAFTA does not deal with services, but with sectors. NAFTA does not define the four modes of supply. Okay, so they are freedom. JTS, four mode of supply. Over here is, you can even move and more than that. So we don't restrict by the four modes of supply. NAFTA requires countries to specify sectors that are not covered by the agreement. So you also have the similar way of treatment where if you're not ready, be transparent. That's what applies. So in a nutshell, EU supports GATS, NAFTA also supports GATS, but they have more supporting rules than GATS. So to make it better. So General Conference act as a legislative body of the ILO, approving conventions and adopting recommendations with regards to human services. So the governing body serves as the ILO executive. It is made up of representatives, as what we have for EU and also for NAFTA. We have the representative from the government, labor and management from each member state. An ILO office headed by by a director general functions as the organization secretary. So they have similar structure as what we have in the NAFTA, also EU or WTO structure. So they have this general office, they have the commission, they have the treaty to govern it. So ILO concerns include all forms of human. What are the standards? International labor standards. ILO attempts to establish rules or standards that have international effect. You know why we need to have rules and standards that have international effect? Do you know why? There are three reasons. States are not inclined to pass labor laws that would create a competitive disadvantage. For example, in Malaysia, we have minimum wage. Is it an advantage or disadvantage for the industry? Disadvantage, because they have to pay more. So, but we have the governing body to impose such a thing, so that we can take care of the human part of it, not the business part of it. The establishment of fair and equitable labor standards help promote world peace. You see, the more equitable standards, the more fair standards imposed by ILO, the more cost to the business. So it is disadvantage again. More safety, for example, more protective equipment to be given to the employee. It's all cost for the organization or the business organization, business enterprise. The establishment of uniform labor standards is a matter of both justice and humanity. So all this, we need such a governing body to set the rules and the standards. So international standards are created by ILO conventions and ILO recommendations. It's part of the structure, as I mentioned earlier. So they have their own structure, they have their own commission, they produce conventions as part of the rules and standards because of these three reasons here. because you must remember, this is two parts of the coin, you know. One is the organization, the other one is a human. We still need to make the organization profitable so that they can pay the salary to the human. But at the same time, we also want to take care of the welfare of the human. So it's a two part of the coin. And the more you do this, the disadvantage for the organization. So we need someone, we need a governing body to dictate this. Because the more you do this, it's a disadvantage. But when you more orient on human, it can also help the organization to become more profitable. So, you know, the two part of the coin. The more you do on human, it can be reciprocated by having more quality service and the company become more profitable. But who want to start this? So we need a governing body such as ILO. Unless the nation has a very good labor standards and policies. The ILO Fact Finding and Conciliation Commission on Freedom of Association, for example, a special ILO committee such as this of inquiry that considers complaints that state has violated some of the freedom of association rules. So these are some of the convention concerning freedom of association where they grant workers the right to form and join trade unions and also to organize and bargain collectively. So this commission, as part of the structure, helps the international community to advocate for freedom of association and also to organize and bargain collectively. As we learn in the GATT, the Advocate Freedom of Goods Movement, GATS, the Freedom of Service, the ILO, Freedom Again on Association, that means you can be free to form your unions, and the other one is to free to form your or develop your bargains, collective agreements. Freedom, again, advocating the freedom on the human. International Labour Office. Any questions or disputes, you can refer to the ICJ. Normally they refer to the ICJ. But they also have this Labour Office. This Labour Office sometimes act as a reference point, because if you want to go to all to ICJ, you take some time and the decision may not arrive so quickly. So sometimes we can refer to the Labour Office for the rules and regulation, and we can use it as a reference point instead of everything go to the ICJ. Okay, some of the settlement disputes, the administrative tribunal of the ILO also as a special court where they hear the complaints from the employees. Okay, and also other 39 other intergovernmental organizations, IGOs, recognize the competence of the tribunal. Apart from ICJ, they can go to a labor office or to the administrative. Human rights. In 1946, the UDHR, is acronym of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, was announced in the UN General Assembly, 1946. At that time, we are not born yet. So it's proclaimed civil and political rights based upon Western civil liberties. Okay. So these are some of the human rights that we need to observe. We cannot violate this, and we can be charged under the UN ICJ. No one shall be held in slavery, subject to torture, for example. If you want to hire someone to work for you, you must pay them salary, not to treat them as a slave. This is under the human rights. And everyone has a right to social security. This is under the Western civil liberty. For example, like eastern part of the world, we don't have social security. We don't have a Middle East also don't have, isn't it? Social security. Like in eastern part of the world, we don't have, like Malaysia, we don't have social security. For example, you see, no job, they will give you monthly allowance, you know. We don't have that. Do we have in Korea, South Korea?
Yeah.
Social security?
Yes.
Wow.
Malaysia,
we don't get paid for that. So in South Korea, you get paid if you don't get a job.
Yeah.
For how long? Until you get a job.
Two years,
huh? In Middle East?
Middle East, all countries they don't have, but in Iran, Kuwait.
Only Iran has, Kuwait.
But depend on, if you work before, yes, but if you never work, you don't have. But if you work before, suddenly you go job test, they pay. The insurance cover you.
They cover you.
Yeah.
Social security, yeah? Rather than you go into robbery. That's why in Malaysia go a lot of robbery. You know, people no job and they go into all these criminal activities. So Iran, Kuwait has, South Korea also has. Everyone has the right to work. Equal pay for equal work, form and join trade union, rest and leisure. That means you must have a break. Our Employment Act 1955 also advocate this part. Education, everyone has the right to. Some of the human rights provinces. Legal effect of UDHR. There are certain countries do not observe UDHR. For example, like Russia, South Africa. But now I don't know whether they have, by the point of writing this textbook, South Africa and Soviet Union do not abstain from adoption of this UDHR, okay, for some reasons, because they fear it would impose some new legal obligations. For example, in South Africa, a lot of labor, child labors, which is against of UDHR. But in South Africa and also many part of the Africa country, child labor is very common. So if you go and adopt UDHR, they will not survive because of the economic condition in the African nation. But it's still excuse. So I don't know why Soviet Union also do not accept this UDHR. So the UDHR has been relied upon by the UN when it applies human rights provision of the UN Charter. So the General Assembly said it is constitutes basic principle of international law. So people can charge you if you go against this. Court decisions have held that UDHR is customary international. So some of the protections of workers' rights by the Council of Europe, for example, you know, convention includes as part of the guarantee for freedom of assembly, the right to join the trade union, some of the in EU, in Europe. For example, opportunity to earn living, you know, occupation freely entered into, just conditions of work, safety, health, fair remuneration, children have right to protected from hazards, employed women when employed have right to special protection in their work, social security, mother to take care of the child for the first 3 years in Sweden, remember? I told you last time, And the husband can apply for leave where he still get paid to take care of the child for the first 3 years. Those kind of human rights. Equality with nationals in same occupation. Right to benefit from social welfare services. Social and medical assistance. Social security. This is Europe. And of course, the movement of workers from one country to another country, where we govern by the passport as an official document. You can get that. And also regulation for foreign workers where we need to have an entry visa for work. Especially like in Europe, European Union countries, you can freely move with just an identification card. You don't have to have a passport. But between other countries, you have to have a proper document. I'm trying to see over here. Okay, done. So comes under the services. We have reviewed GATS and we have reviewed how the EU and the NAFTA compare and how the ILO structure, the commission and the conventions are governing the human, because we know some other organization will perceive this as a disadvantage for them to have more welfare towards human, and how the human rights also protect the human in terms of equality under the United Nations.